to the next segment of the Tertis Pavlov Project. In this segment, I'm going to talk about what is a Tertis Viola. The Tertis Viola is named after Lionel Tertis, and how it came to be is kind of an interesting story. The viola is kind of the bastard child of the string family. String quartets and orchestras like to have the quality of the viola sound to complement the other strings, but the viola is rarely a solo instrument. There's been relatively little music composed specifically for the viola. Major composers like Mozart, Bach, Beethoven did not compose works specifically for a solo viola, and that's kind of a shame. Lionel Tertis was the first of the modern virtuoso viola players, and I suspect, as other viola players, he might have been a little bit envious of violinists and pianists who get to play concertos with orchestra and play the solo part. And so he wanted to make the viola a solo instrument. And he had two problems to solve in achieving that goal. The first problem was that most violas have a fairly subdued kind of mellow sound. They don't have the kind of brilliance of tone that allows the sound of the viola to be heard above an orchestral background, unlike the violin. And so in trying to turn the viola into a solo instrument, Tertis was concerned about creating a more brilliant sounding viola. The other problem he had to solve is to find music that would be appropriate for a solo viola. So that turned out to be easier to take care of. He commissioned a lot of solo works for the viola, and so there were probably more concertos for the viola written in the 20th century than in all prior centuries of musical composition. Hindemith, Walton, Bartok, there are lots of modern viola concertos and other solo viola works. So that takes care of the repertoire. How about the instrument? Tertis was a viola player, he was not an instrument maker, and so he had to get together with an instrument maker who was interested in this problem, was willing to work with him in creating a more brilliant sounding instrument. And he got together with another Englishman by the name of Arthur Richardson, who mostly made violins, but he and Tertis got together and they started designing different types of violas and finally settled on what has come to be called the Tertis Viola. I acquired this viola somewhat by chance when I was a student at the Juilliard School. Someone had retired, a professional viola player retired or passed away, I'm not sure which, and his family was trying to settle the estate and distribute his property, and so they approached Juilliard and gave him, wanted the instrument to be put in the hands of a promising student, and somehow I got to have the instrument. And I knew it was a Tertis Viola, but I didn't know what that meant. Until a few years ago, when my brother gave me a biography of Lionel Tertis. This is a biography that was written by John White, published in 2006, in which John White spelled out sort of the origins of the Tertis Viola in this collaboration with Arthur Richardson. And when I read this account, I immediately looked inside my viola, and sure enough, it's hard to see in this light, but it's called, the label inside is a capital R period T period, viola number 122, and then it says Tertis model, And underneath it said it was made by Arthur Richardson. So the initials RT-122 referred to Richardson and Tertis, I presume, but Arthur Richardson signed his name on the instrument, and he actually signed his name not just on the label, but on the wooden part above the label. And the date is 1954. In reading about this in Tertis's biography, evidently Richardson made about 190 large violas. About 145, 150 of these were Tertis violas. And in 1954, when this viola was made, Arthur Richardson was about 72 years old. Now, what's distinctive about this design is that it's not particularly long, but it has a really wide section over here, and it's thicker than the normal viola, and it has a marvelous sound. I just love the sound of this instrument. I read in some program notes last year that musicians don't own good instruments. The instruments own them. And when the instrument is finished with one musician, it goes on to live with another. That's certainly true about this instrument. What's also true about this instrument is that it found me rather than me finding it. I started playing the viola only because I had the instrument. Prior to that, I had been taking violin lessons. So had I not come into the possession of this instrument, I would have never learned to play the viola, I suspect. And I've carried the viola with me ever since, wherever I went, even though for many years I didn't actually play it. So I dragged it to graduate school in psychology, even though I didn't have time to play it in graduate school. And every time I moved, I left various things behind that I didn't need, but I always took my viola with me, along with the viola. The family gave me a lot of chamber music. There was bound editions of all Mozart string quartets and Haydn string quartets, Beethoven string quartets, beautiful sets of music. I'd left those behind, and it turns out my folks' house had a very serious fire, so I lost all the music. But fortunately, when the fire occurred, I wasn't living at home, and I had my viola with me in Canada, where I was going to graduate school. So this has been a very special instrument, and I just love the sound of it, and I hope that you do as well.